This planet Earth turns slowly. It's hard to say that I'd rather stay awake when I'm asleep, because my dreams are bursting at the seams.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to AI Talk, a Zoom show about AI technology and life. I'm your host, Karen Hao, and we are here today for the third of 5 pilot episodes. If you joined us in the last 2 weeks, it's amazing that you're back. And if you're here for the first time, welcome. We're broadcasting every Wednesday at 5:30 p.m. Eastern Time, and each episode features an incredible guest speaker and a conversation about their work and life. So this show came out of my personal need to have a little bit of laughter and mental sanity during the times that we're in. It's not an MIT Technology Review show, in case that wasn't clear. So what that means is you'll notice that the production might be a little bit glitchy or unpolished at times, and that's because it's just me. There's no production team behind me. It also means that this show is very much a work in progress. So I will send out a survey after this episode to ask you what you did and didn't like. And thank you to those of you who already filled out the surveys for the last previous episodes. They've been very helpful in improving the show. A note is about Zoom bombing. We've done what we can on our end to prevent it from happening. But if it does, we will end the show immediately, and Deb and I will record the episode by ourselves and then send out a link to all of the attendees. We now also have a landing page, which I'll drop in the chat later, that has all of the episodes, so you can watch them at your leisure after they happen. Thank you for being willing to experiment with us and hopefully have some fun in the process. So at this point, I am super excited to introduce our guest for today. Deb Raji is a tech fellow at AI Now, a New York-based research institute that studies the social impact of AI. And her research spans a ton of different things: algorithm bias, AI governance and accountability practices, and one of my personal favorites, how the field currently does its research and why. In January of last year, her work with Joy Balamwini on the discrimination of commercial face recognition systems was profiled by the New York Times. And in addition to being a badass, Deb is also just a fountain of energy and good humor. She's also Canadian, a super middle child of 5, and like any sensible person, loves pineapple on pizza. Deb, welcome to the show.
glad to be here. Yeah. You forgot to mention I'm like Irene. I also read Wikipedia articles.
You guys absolutely have to bond.
I was gonna say we can read a movie together.
I love the reaction someone just put, no. I think that's to the pineapple pizza, which I also like absolutely love. Anyway, so I wanted to start by defining some of the terms that I threw out in your bio: algorithmic bias, governance, accountability, because I think these words are often overused to the point where they become meaningless. So I'm curious what those terms mean to you and how you actually delineate your research interests.
Yeah, so the way I've sort of connected it all in my mind is to this concept of, algorithmic accountability and auditing. And what that really boils down to is I'm very sort of fascinated by real world deployments of AI. I think sometimes when we talk about AI, people like to imagine it as sort of this abstract project, whereas in the real world, there's many ways that AI is currently deployed. It's in a lot of, even in Canada, I recently was reading a report about how the Canadian social security system is like end-to-end automated, and that causes certain issues. So there's algorithms sort of all around us. And my goal is sort of framed around, how can we actually hold these algorithms accountable when they make mistakes? How can you record how they perform for different, sub-demographic groups? Do they perform equally for everyone? Do they actually function in the way that we hope that they function? Are they achieving the goals that we say that they're achieving? Are we writing all of this down as evidence to be used in court? So that's kind of how I articulate the broader scope of what I'm working on. And then with respect to some of these like sub areas of like, accountability and policy, it's more about just, how do we make improvements off of that. So within the policy and AI accountability and governance space, it's more about what are the structures we can build inside an org and what are the structures we can build within a government in order to establish checkpoints in order to understand how the system is functioning at different checkpoints of development, of deployment, and of impact. And then a lot of the work around, you know, what we would call like algorithmic auditing or algorithmic bias is, you know, how can we actually, like, how can our evaluations and how can our evaluation process reveal these disparities? What are the metrics that we need to be looking at? What are the populations that we need to be looking at and categories, and how do we define that? And what's the process to establish that? And that's sort of the work that I lump under sort of the algorithmic bias and algorithmic auditing, I guess, like category or framework.
Yeah.
Those are sort of the two ways I separate things. It's like one is sort of establishing organizational checkpoints, and then the other one is actually asking a question of like, what are the numbers I need to see to like figure out that there's a problem in the first place?
Yeah, that's a really great distinction. And I wanted to talk about the study that was profiled in the New York Times, because I feel like that study and like the Gender Shades project at large mm-hmm. basically popularized algorithmic auditing. Like,
yeah.
It was like the study that introduced this concept. So I'm going to drop the link for the New York Times story in this chat so people can read it when yeah. they want to. But why don't we first start with talking about the prelude to your paper, which was the original Gender Shades project. Could you tell
me? Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So it was really interesting. I guess I can like, I don't know if you want me to tell the whole like origin story of how everything happened or if it's just like.
Sure. Why not?
Okay. Yeah. Because it's all connected in a way. So I was working on the applied machine learning team at Clarify, which is this computer vision company. This is like 2016, 2017. No one was really using the term algorithmic bias. No one was really interested in AI ethics at all. It was before the major embarrassments and disasters happened. So a lot of people were just ignoring it as a problem. And some of the things I noticed right away while working was that there was a huge lack of representation of people of color in a lot of the mainstream data sets that we use, especially for facial recognition. So it was something that I'd actually independently noticed at Clarify, and I was trying to figure out who else has noticed this. And the other person that had noticed this and that was working on this was Joy Bluemwini at the MIT Media Lab. And at that point, she had put out a TED Talk, and the simple sort of premise of her TED Talk was, facial recognition algorithms don't work for me because I'm a Black female and I'm trying to figure out why. So I reached out to her, and at that point, she'd actually started working on Gender Shade. So I was able to like get an insider look and help out with really like sort of menial tasks on this project. And what that project ended up evolving into was she created a benchmark. So the way that we sort of evaluate for fairness in computer vision systems at this point is to say that, okay, you know, I have a data set that I use to teach my model about how to represent and understand the world. I have a separate data set that I use to evaluate the performance of this model. The issue is that in computer vision and especially facial recognition, the demographics of these benchmarks, the test data set and the training data set are incredibly skewed. I'm saying like 85% plus white faces, 75% plus male faces. There's some really prominent base data sets that are 95% plus white faces. So because of that skew, no one was actually understanding how these models performed for darker females versus lighter males or anything like that. So Joy's first move was to create a benchmark, which we called the pilot parliaments benchmark, which actually was one of the first benchmarks and was sort of the first sort of publicly used facial recognition benchmark that was balanced for skin type. So like, you know, lighter versus darker skin and gender. So male and female. So it was the first sort of balanced benchmark for gender and skin type. And, you know, once we took off the shelf facial recognition products that were already deployed, in the case of Amazon, it was being sold to ICE and being sold to the police for use. So these are not, you know, experimental projects or research models that we were auditing. We were auditing actual products that people had already released into the world. And once we evaluated it on this benchmark, we found that there was, something like 60% or less accuracy on the darker female subgroup and, you know, almost 100% accuracy on the lighter male subgroup. And that huge disparity of like 30% plus was so alarming that the New York Times was like, oh, okay, this is like a story. And I think it really brought to attention the fact that one, you know, our benchmarks, that what we use to conceive or think about a model working is itself biased. So a lot of these test sets that we use in industry are actually skewed towards telling a very particular narrative of like, this model works, but for whom does it work? And does that test that actually represent who it's going to be used for? And then I guess the other second question too was like, how could we possibly, like, how is it possible that, you know, a whole team at Microsoft and at all these big companies at IBM, at Facebook+, at Amazon had trained these models, developed them, deployed them without properly testing them on these subpopulations that they would be used on. So that's what really set up the, you know, the Gender Shades project. And I'm like, we're like thrilled that it was able to have the impact it does. And then the second sort of follow-up work that we did, sort of focusing on Amazon, but also other, I guess like products that were not in the initial audit, was to ask the question of what's the impact of gender shades. So the companies that we called out in the gender shades audit, did they get better after they were called out? And the answer was yes, they improved their performance on PPB, but you know, there's still privacy issues and other things that they're being now held accountable for. And then in the case of sort of Amazon and other companies that were not initially called out, they still had like ridiculous disparity. So it's still an industry-wide shift that needs to happen.
Yeah, that was one thing that I really loved about the Gender Shades Project is that it had the two parts. Like it first audited a certain subset of companies and then went back a year later, was it?
Yeah,
a year later and re-audited the same companies, but then also looked at new companies that had developed face recognition systems. And it is kind of crazy the impact that auditing can have when companies get called out, like how quickly they were able to reduce the disparity.
They get so scared too. I think it's because of the legal implications, if I'm being honest. Like, this is something that comes out in my other work around auditing. So I've also been involved in a lot of work pushing for documentation practice in the auditing space. So getting companies internally to start recording some of these things. A lot of what I've learned through this process is that right now the way that a lot of companies learn about the algorithmic bias in their systems is when they're called out on it, and then they become scared because there's like a PR issue or a legal issue. So we're not yet at the point where, you know, there's sort of like the benevolent incentive, but I think some of these external audits like gender shades, there's also been really great work on Predpol, on child services and different types of algorithms. I love this sort of new wave of algorithmic audits because it's beginning to remind companies of their responsibility, and it's sort of pushing them into a corner where they actually have to take action.
Yeah. I mean, that ties really well into the work that you do on AI governance, because auditing is only part of the solution, because that's sort of the external force that's incentivizing people to change their practices. But then governance is like the internal structures that allow audits to actually be so terrible. What have you seen since this new wave of algorithmic auditing? Have you seen companies actually start wrapping their heads around having better systems for doing these practices internally and making sure their AI systems are safe?
I think like a huge part of this is around, like I said, communication and documentation. I think there was a before this sort of wave of people, you know, taking things into their own hands, designing their own test sets and pilots, and then exposing sort of the gaps of performance of these systems. I think before that sort of public record became known, companies themselves, even internally, did not do this testing. They didn't vet their own systems and sort of examine all of these corner cases of like how things could go wrong and for whom. And, you know, this comes up a lot, but, you know, some of these companies are not even necessarily thinking about, you know, these some underrepresented or underconsidered populations, right? Like they might not be thinking about, you know, how does my model work for, you know, people of color or Black women, specifically like this intersection. That doesn't come to mind, or that didn't come to mind for the longest time. So I think this wave of external audits are now pushing companies to say like, okay, we need to like get ahead of this and communicate our performance on these populations, because if we don't, then an external auditor will do that for us and we'll be put in a corner. So I think now we're seeing a lot of internal language around, you know, intersectionality and some of these concepts. Yeah, like some of these things where you're like, whoa, there's like, you know, someone at a company, you know, getting paid to think about fairness and thinking about responsible innovation and some of these things. And I don't really think that's been a thing before. And then the other sort of second part of that is, you know, Microsoft and Google, like Google has model cards, Microsoft has transparency notes, but there's been a lot of initiative around communication and documentation. And I don't think that was a thing before. So I think some of these companies are now like, okay, even if we are not in a position to make our product fully, you know, functional for everyone, we're gonna at least disclose the amount of testing that we have done and put that open, open that up to critique so that if someone says, oh, you didn't test for this population or you didn't look at this, that dialogue can now happen. And I think for a long time, the testing processes around AI systems was very closed off. So because there was no documentation, like even the engineer didn't know, you know, how a system was tested. Now that there's documents, at least there's internal dialogue and to some extent external dialogue around like, you know, what did you check for? What is the performance of the model on this group versus that group, this age group or that age group? That dialogue can actually begin to happen. So I think it's like a step zero. Yeah. So like, you know, forward baby steps are definitely happening. But yeah, it's definitely changed the way that companies think about it. I think one of my favorite things to think about is like Amazon. I think Amazon is like, my experience with Amazon was sort of like a caricature of the experience we had with other companies where Amazon was like very defensive for a long time.
Yeah, they were.
Yeah. And it like took like, I really appreciate that because the research community really like came to our defense and they like were like, this is a peer reviewed thing. And then subsequent studies reproduced our results and then NIST, like a lot of like federal agencies reproduced our results. So now Amazon is like, not looking very good, but they were very vocally defensive. But then we would, you know, find out that like internally they were like really invested in like trying to fix their systems. Yeah, so it was this weird thing of like, you know, publicly trying to really protect themselves against the negative publicity, which is understandable as a company. But then internally they were actually doing a lot to you know, try to improve their performance on our benchmark, trying to minimize fairness. They had hired a whole fairness team, invested a lot in documentation as well, invested a lot in consultants and things like that. So it was like, you know, even the company that was the most vocally stubborn with respect to like accepting the results actually changed a lot as a result of us calling them out. So I think ultimately it was worth it. Yeah.
This ties a lot also to your benchmarking work, because I think when you did the Gender Stage project, one of the radical ideas, I mean, the entire thing was like pretty radical for the field, but like one of them was the fact that, as you said, benchmark data sets used to evaluate models are like themselves skewed, and no one's ever thought to really think about like everyone's always focused on the training data. No one ever is focused on the testing data.
Yeah.
And you have been working now on a project to kind of look at different benchmarking practices in the field and kind of question whether or not they even do what they say they're supposed to do. So could you talk about that?
Yeah. I like get excited talking about it because it's like evaluation is such an interesting aspect of machine learning, like historically, like it defines the sort of direction of progress of the field. People sort of run towards benchmarks. And I'm sure like, you know, machine learning researchers in this call are probably very familiar with like the concept of like soda chasing and trying to get to the state of the art performance on a particular benchmark and trying to manipulate the algorithm to optimize performance on a benchmark. So it's so central to the like the culture in machine learning. But once you start actually looking at what these benchmarks represent, either as tasks or if you look at the data, diversity of the data, or even the metrics that we choose to optimize for, you start noticing some of these like discrepancies. So yeah, one is sort of a gender shades type thing, which is, you know, that is Joy's genius, I think, which was identifying that, you know, the reason why we can't really call out this phenomenon of, because initially the point was like, oh, how do we articulate our experience as Black women of having all of these facial recognition systems fail on us. Yeah. Her insight that like the reason we can't articulate this or express this experience is because the evaluation, the benchmark itself does not actually represent us or include us. And I think that was sort of such an important lesson for me to learn. And I'm so happy that I was able to work with her early on because it really spurred a lot of the subsequent work I'm doing right now, which is like asking that question of like, okay, well, what are these other real world failures that we struggle to articulate because it's not actually encapsulated in the benchmark itself. A lot of this happens in very different ways. So one way that this is showing itself is like natural language processing as a space. And I've been reading, a couple of people are sort of beginning to pick up on this. There's a great paper by Emily Bender. I just noticed there's, you know, another paper at ACL that also sort of presents this view of like the concept of natural language understanding is a well-established concept in linguistics. You know, there are evaluations and evaluation criteria for what it means to understand language. We have tests to like measure and quantify and discuss, you know, language development in humans, but why are we getting like, you know, natural language, like NLP models to sort of like solve SAT questions? What's the connection between, because, you know, they have like question answering, they have like, you know, analogy questions, like that's sort of the type of tasks that the NLP benchmarks are based off of. And, you know, there's also in NLP, there's like this ideal of like a general language model. And it's like, well, when you look at real world applications of NLP, like how connected is that concept of general performance to the real world applications? So yeah, again, it's sort of this exercise of like looking at things failing in the real world. So like, you know, I think we've all experienced a really bad chatbot or just a really bad chatbot or like a really bad like autofill, you know, system. So it's like all these failures that we see, sometimes it's difficult to articulate them because our evaluations don't actually capture the full nature or even properly abstract the nature of the way things fail in the real world. A paper that I really, really like was like written in like 2011 or 2010, I think, by Kiri Wagstaff. And it resurfaced on Twitter literally today. So that's pretty interesting. But I had like given this talk where I pointed to her paper, and it's like sort of my North Star through all of this. So Kiri Wagstaff was like a researcher, she was a scientist, and then she kind of, for her sabbatical, she dipped her toes into the machine learning space. And she was so mad that she wrote this rant paper. It's like well-written, it's a well-written rant, but like her whole point is that like, you know, machine learning as it stands, because the benchmarks are so arbitrary, because the metrics don't really connect to the real world problems it's purporting to solve, it ends up being sort of useless for the people that want to make use of it. So yeah, that's like sort of this recurring theme that's coming up with evaluation, is like, how can we actually make our evaluation processes reflective of what we want machine learning models to do? Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's been a fun process so far.
Yeah, I think the work that you're doing on benchmarking is so fascinating. And when you first showed it to me, I was like, wow, I've never thought about it this way.
Yeah.
Also, to address Sandeep's question, so last time I promised everyone that I would send out links to things after, and then I totally forgot. So I promise I will do it this time. I will be, when I post the video, I actually put in the description on YouTube all of the links.
Okay, nice. So, yeah.
Yeah, so Deb and I will collect those.
Yeah.
Okay, we're now going to play a game.
This is why I'm here. I'm here to play the game.
What?
So I'm here for the game.
Yeah. I'm going to share my screen and hold on one sec. Okay. Okay, so can everyone see my screen? Okay, so we're gonna play a game of hot or not.
Yeah.
Where you get to decide, Deb, whether you approve of something. And this week, that thing is a machine learning based social distancing detector. So for more context, I need to press play. So for more context, Andrew Ng, who is like a big hotshot in the AI world, started a new startup in 2017 called Landing AI, to bring AI to the manufacturing industry. And as an example, one of their first strategic partners and clients is Foxconn. So last week, the startup released a blog post about how to use machine learning to maintain social distancing protocol, saying that they had, quote, built this prototype at the request of customers whose businesses are deemed essential during this time.
Yeah.
So, Deb, what do you think about this?
I have this whole like slogan of what I've been saying throughout this whole pandemic, which is like, I don't think tech is going to be the thing that's going to save us. Like, I don't think tech is going to be like if they built this or if they didn't build this, that's going to determine whether, the pandemic is going to end earlier or not. I think a lot of the tech solutions that people have been throwing at this pandemic might not necessarily be the most impactful things. And it just feels like unnecessary surveillance and shaming too. I'm not a huge fan. I'm also like, keep in mind, you're talking to someone that is like constantly auditing and reading about problematic AI deployments. So this reminds me, I was just talking to you about this, like there's a company called Athena and they have like a fever detection system that they overlaid over security footage in order to identify who might have a fever based off of their body temperature. And it's just like, you know, this level of surveillance is just unnecessary and potentially unhelpful. So why go down the rabbit hole? So yeah, I'm very not into it.
Yeah, I think
too many bad memories of, yeah.
Yeah, I think one thing that has always been true of the AI community, but I think the pandemic has sort of exacerbated, is like the debate around how to actually have social impact with AI. Like there's sort of been like two camps that I've come across, where some people are like, oh, here are all the amazing ways that we can use AI right now to solve the pandemic. And then there are other people who are just like, stop, please. Machine learning researchers, you can't do anything to solve the pandemic. Like, do something else.
The thing is, like, there's ways you can be helpful that are just not like super flashy and exciting and like sexy, like ML solutions. And like, that's the thing that I find so funny, like, you know, someone is willing to sort of build a system in order to, you know, surveil people and figure out the distance and, you know, shame them if they're not, you know, far enough away from other people. But no one is willing to like volunteer to, you know, write in COBOL to like fix the unemployment like system, or, you know what I mean? Like debug, like, or clean data, you know, like all the like unsexy, like, tech things you can do, people are not interested in doing. So I find that so, like, you know, like, I'm like, okay, like, I don't know if your goal is even to like truly help, or if you just want to like sort of show off what you can do with machine learning, which is like, you know, everyone has their own incentives for that. And there's definitely value in terms of demonstrating what machine learning can do. So, you know, the AI for social good space has been critiqued about this, where it's just like, are you kind of just, is this just a display case for sort of what AI can do versus focused on the actual problem solving? But I think, like, you know, there's arguments you can make for both of those being valid directions. But yeah, in a case of a pandemic, it becomes a little bit frustrating to see in deployment. Like, my issue is just like, you can do whatever you want in research, but once it comes to like actually affecting people's lives, then yeah, then that's when I like, you know, I'm ready to fight for people's protection. It can become problematic.
I feel like we already know the answer to this question, but so do you think this is hot or not?
Yeah, I would say it's a low sizzle, but like, yeah, probably not. Just like, you know, what's it when like the lowest is it sizzling when you just like the lowest like
simmer? You're trying to low simmer.
Yeah, a low simmer, exactly. Yeah, yeah. You know, it's like interesting tech and they're definitely demonstrating the potential of the technology, but I'm not sure if it's actually gonna be helpful. And I really hope they don't deploy it, because if they deploy it, there's all of these other things they need to think about that they don't have time to think about before they deploy it to fix the pandemic.
Helen Edwards has a question. What do you think of Clearview AI and Palantir being part of the COVID solutions? How would we even get any kind of audit on those?
Clearview AI, people have been trying to get at that target, especially since Clearview is like not actually, they don't have really good security, which is even more problematic because they have so much face data. So yeah, people have been sort of trying to audit, analyze Clearview, and there's some really good articles doing that. And I can maybe ping Karen about those. But I think, yeah, Clearview has been exposed thoroughly at this point. Palantir is very elusive and very difficult to, as an external auditor, understand from the outside, mostly because they're a business-to-business company, so they don't actually have a lot of consumer-facing products. And the main strategy right now, in the current form of external auditing, or is that you sort of pretend to be a consumer in order to learn information about the performance of the system. So for a business-to-business product like Palantir's AI system, AI like APIs and things and products, it's very difficult for an external auditor to learn anything about the system without going too far and like breaking their terms of service. There was a recent ACLU lawsuit that they actually, a recent ACLU case that they had actually won with Christian Sandvig, where they actually were able to guarantee protections for people doing research on algorithmic bias and algorithmic auditing, so that if you break the terms of service for the company, you're not going to be like legally liable and you're not going to go to jail. So it was a really big win. So, you know, now that we have these protections, maybe we can try more things to be able to access these systems and like be a little craftier without being scared that we're going to be sued, or without being scared that we're going to like, you know, cross a line. Yeah, like it's still very difficult for like a business to business type company like Palantir. So yeah, Palantir is very tricky. I think the other thing too is Palantir is not very transparent, right? So even the products that they offer to certain businesses versus the products that they're offering to the government, they don't disclose a lot of information about, yeah. So it's very difficult for Palantir. And yeah, Clearview though, I think a lot of people have been trying to target Clearview, and there's been a little bit of work on that already.
Yeah. If there are other people who have questions, feel free to pop them in the chat and we'll have more of an AMA at the end. But I have a couple more questions for you. Okay. So I'd love to talk more about how you actually got started in AI research, because you didn't actually intend to study that in college, right? That was a thing
No.
you found your way into.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. That's life, like, right? Yeah. So I studied robotics engineering at U of T, and I was thinking I would be like a software engineer or a machine learning engineer. I kind of was really inept. I was like so in love with the startup space, and I was like, this is such an innovative, exciting space. So yeah, I was doing a lot of hackathons. I was like building stuff, and I was like, this is so fun. So yeah, I was focused on like startup life. And then because I was so interested in startups, that's how I ended up at Clarify, because I was like, oh, this is a startup. I didn't even care about machine learning. It's really funny. People were like, remember when you almost didn't want to go there because you were like, oh, what's machine learning? Like, you know what I mean? Like, I wasn't even the machine learning part of it. And then obviously at Clarify, you know, they do computer vision. So I learned a lot about machine learning there. I learned a lot about computer vision there. And it was really funny. I told you this story earlier, but in 2017, NeurIPS, back then it was called NIPS, but it was happening in Long Beach.
Like the biggest AI.
Yeah, it's like the biggest AI conference, research conference. And they had like taken me along because they needed someone to help with like the recruitment dinner or something like that. And then I ended up sort of sneaking into a couple talks. I was like, wow, this is like super fascinating. You know, I had been on the engineering side for a very long time, so to be in the research environment was very different and very exciting. And then while I was at NeurIPS, literally Timnit Gebru, she's a co-lead of the ethical AI team at Google, and she's like a Black woman, and you know, there was like maybe like a sprinkle of us at NeurIPS. So she sees me and she's just like, oh my gosh, you have to come to this like Black and AI event. It's super important that you come. And I was like, I don't know you, but like, sure, this like sounds really exciting and really important. So yeah, that was why I ended up like moving my flight and like staying an extra day so I could go to this Black and AI workshop. And it was such an important experience for me to like feel represented and like see, like it was a very, very small community at that point. So NeurIPS is like 8,000 people, strong conference, and Black and AI was like 50 at most at the first workshop, like 50 to like at most 100, including allies. So it was a very small workshop compared to every other workshop at the conference. It was like a very small group of people, but it was important for me to sort of see like, oh, you know, there's people that look like me that are really succeeding in this field, that are really doing well. So that was so encouraging. And then I kind of came back super energized to do a good job. So yeah, that was pretty much like, that was an important sort of moment for me in my career. And then after that, I kind of reached out to Joy and everything kind of came after that.
Yeah. And like, now, like Black and AI was like one of the smallest workshops back then, but now it's like so big, and like the thing that happens every year is blowout. Yeah. And like I went for the first time last year, and I was like, holy crap! Like, literally, room is stacked with like the best minds thinking about like ethics, algorithmic bias, like all of those things. It's really incredible.
I was going to say, my favorite part about any of the affinity groups, so like WIML and Queer and AI and Black and AI, it's like each of them have their thing. Like, I think Black and AI, there's a lot of people doing sort of AI for social good for the developing world, because there's a lot of people, you know, from an African perspective, or even people with like justice-oriented projects, because they're coming in from the African-American sort of lens. And then in Queer and AI, they do a lot of work questioning categories and categorization in machine learning. Like, it's just like interestingly thematically on point. I'm like, yes, like each of these groups really has like the angle and the perspective that they bring into this space that is so unique. So that's what I really love about those affinity groups and creating spaces for those people. Yeah, like, you know, disability in AI talks a lot about the accessibility of the systems that we build with machine learning. Like, everyone is really like leveraging their perspective and bringing a diverse viewpoint to the field, like to the research. And it's like really high quality work as a result. So I like get very excited when I attend these workshops.
Yeah, same. We are running out of time. So I want to address the questions, but I also really, really want to talk about your conspiracy theories on the industry. Okay, so for context, what I didn't mention in your bio is that you've basically worked in every possible environment. So you've worked in academia at the MIT Media Lab, you've worked in industry at Google, you're now at a nonprofit, you worked at a startup, you also were at Partnership on AI, which is like a consortium for for-profits, nonprofits, and startups. So you've literally spanned like all of the different ways that AI research is conducted today. And I think you have a really unique perspective on one of the longest standing debates in the industry, which is like how much we should be allowing big tech companies to drive AI research.
Yeah.
So do you want to talk about your conspiracy?
I was like, I will keep it short because I see the time, but yeah, we had this, the context is me and Karen had this like fun dinner where I just like exposed the fact that I have a lot of thoughts. I'm having this full scope of experience of different people and different incentives. But the TLDR is that like the industry influence in machine learning is very strong. And I think it does do a lot to shape the research agenda of the community. So those that are sort of involved in ML research might have noticed that there is this bias towards like, again, you know, there's this soda chasing culture of we want to beat the performance on this benchmark. And people will do things like add layers to their neural network. They love this concept of, you know, compute, the more compute, the better, the more data, the better. But all of this is very biased towards advantages for sort of industry research. So these companies have an infinite amount of data, they have infinite resources for compute. And I think the research direction might actually look very differently if it wasn't so industry influenced. And then an easy way to see this, and I'm like actually thinking of doing some kind of write-up on this, is the ImageNet competition is very fascinating to observe, because you start off with like, you know, the academia involvement, and you sort of see like step, you know, the difference between the winner in 1 year and the next year is some kind of like theoretical advancement. And then later on, you sort of have like Google and Microsoft getting more involved. And, you know, the difference between Google and that and like the precedent was like 120 layers of the neural network, and the performance improvement was like 0.8%. I'm beginning to understand like, you know, certain ways that the industry influence in machine learning is actually like affecting the way that we do scholarship. And, you know, they're also the ones that are sort of pushing certain positions, like we should focus on sponsoring compute for academia in order for the playground to be level. And I'm like, well, we could, but we could also like
develop techniques.
Redesign our problem space a little bit. So yeah, that's my position right now. You know, for more conspiracy theories, you know, you can follow up with me.
Perfect. Okay, there's this really good question from earlier that in your saving face paper, you talk about the tension between privacy and fairness. Do you think that privacy is inherently at odds with fairness, or is there a way to approach fairness while preserving user privacy?
Yeah, I think like it becomes very challenging. So for context, the saving face paper was sort of a reflection on, so we were seeing like gender shades style audits really take off. And something that concerned us was that people were trying to use it in policy. So they were trying to set up like a gender shades audit as like the criteria for a system to be deemed usable. So they would say, you know, if the facial recognition system, you know, does this well on gender shades on the benchmark that we've developed, and it has this, you know, if, and it's deemed as unbiased, then we can just deploy it. And we're like, hold up, there's all of these other questions you need to ask. There's all of these other things you need to think about. It's not just about the benchmark. And actually there's like an unethical approach to doing this kind of auditing. And one of the things that we saw with gender shades was trying to beat gender shades requires you to diversify your training set. And sometimes the ways that people would try to diversify the training set were like fully unethical, right? Targeting Black and brown communities to collect their data without their consent, paying for their data. So that was the tension that that was brought up here around like, we want to protect the privacy of these sort of underrepresented and vulnerable communities. We don't want them to be more at risk of like data harvesting just because they're underrepresented in mainstream data sets. But on the other hand, we do want the models to perform well across different populations. So how do we actually balance that tension? I don't think it's inherently at odds. I think that something that I'm reflecting on too is like, you know, there's assumptions that create this tension. So the large data requirement that we've established as the default or the norm in machine learning, like, could we begin to question that? Could we begin to explore methods that don't necessarily require this, like, you know, mass harvesting of faces in order to get the model to perform in a way that's desirable. And then the other thing too is about like collective and community participation and engagement. Something like facial recognition, you know, is it appropriate for use at all in particular communities? How much is that community actually engaged in the process? There's been a lot of work by Data for Black Lives around this concept of data trust and actually getting the community to volunteer their data for the sake of auditing these systems and holding these systems accountable for fairness goals and for for anti-discriminatory goals. So I think in those concepts where there's community buy-in and community engagement as part of the fairness evaluation process, maybe we can actually begin to, have some level of consent with respect to, you know, I'm going to offer my data under whatever conditions of like protection and privacy so that I can move this product towards a particular fairness objective. I highly suggest looking at the work of Data for Black Lives on this. They've been doing a lot of conversations on data trust, and I think there's definitely other groups. I think Algorithm Watch is also another group that's been writing about this.
Another question from Cody. I loved hearing you bring up NLP and bias. I wonder if you have any good examples of language models embedding biases or other NLP issues.
Yeah.
I'm like, think of like so many, but
Karen, do you want to answer this? Karen has written a bunch of great articles on this actually. In terms of bias, you know, one of the big ones I see with respect to NLP bias translating to harmful applications in the real world is the commonly cited example of you know, either autocorrect, so like not autocomplete, sorry, so sentence completion. So I'm beginning to type a sentence and then I complete the sentence with something that is inherently awful, like inherently offensive or stereotypical or incorrect. And then also translation is a big one. So, you know, assuming gender roles based off of stereotypes and, you know, so, you know, a gender neutral word in one, a gender neutral pronoun in one language being translated to he is a doctor versus she is a nurse. So these are like common examples of like bias in NLP. There was actually a great workshop, the measurement of bias in NLP is currently a little bit under debate. There was a great workshop or discussion sort of hosted by Hannah Wallach and Hal Dumais and some other NLP folks, where there was a little bit of a debate as to, you know, how do we actually measure bias in NLP? Because previously people would say, you know, and this again goes to like the SAT type questions that they keep asking NLP models. So one of these SAT type questions is like the analogy question of like, you know, man is to computer programmer as woman is to X, right? And you know, it would be like woman is to homemaker, and everyone would be like, oh my gosh, that's like super stereotypical and problematic. Some other researchers came in and they were like, well, actually, the reason it's like this is because you can't use the same word. And if you change the rules, then you actually have the analogy ends up becoming like man is to doctor as woman is to doctor, or man is to computer programmer as woman is to computer programmer. But because you take the next suitable word, that's how you end up with like, you know, homemaker or nurse. And if you had switched it around, it would be the same thing. And so there's a lot of debate around how to measure bias in NLP right now. And again, it goes back to like, what are we asking these NLP models and how does it actually connect to this real world harm? For me, the analogies, like the debate around the analogies and if that's a good use of measurement of NLP bias, it feels disconnected from the reality of like how that bias actually happens, which is, like I said, through the translation stuff, through the autocomplete. Like, I feel like we should be focusing on trying to evaluate things with respect to how these problems actually manifest when we try to bring them into products and when we try to actually sort of deploy these systems. So I think that's like my inclination, is like, I would love to see more bias evaluations that are anchored to these real world cases of like harmful NLP predictions.
Yeah, totally. We have totally blown past every episode. Like, the time passes faster and faster, and I'm like, what's happening?
Like, I just said hi to you 2 seconds ago.
I know, but we should let people go, but I'm gonna drop this link, which is like the landing page for the show, so that if you wanna look at previous episodes, and when this episode goes up, it'll also be there. And then in the comments on YouTube, it'll have all of the links to the articles and things. Mm-hmm. I'll also send out an email to people who are registered for this particular episode. So thank you so much, everyone, for showing up. And thank you to Deb for being an awesome person and researcher and fountain of knowledge. Like, I learn so much from you every time I talk to you. So
thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.